Welcome to Co-op Mode Video Game Reviews, where a monthly video game podcast where four guys talk about a video game of their choice. I'm Mike Espy.
I'm Josh Ackerman.
And I'm Ben Teed. What a week, or a month, I mean.
Yeah.
It has been.
Yeah, it is. It's been interesting. And today we are discussing Josh's pick, Bayonetta.
Which Man, is, when was Josh's last pick?
It's been a while.
It's been a while. Yeah. I mean, I can't recall.
It's been a while.
Don't start busting out some 2000s, man. That's some high school shit for me right there.
A little stained.
Yeah.
I like the way Josh said that. It's a little stained.
You got some stains on my stained.
Okay.
I don't even know when your last one was. I'm looking.
Yeah.
I can't tell.
It's been Tomb Raider, maybe? No, it might have been Half-Life 2.
Half-Life 2?
Oh, yeah. I didn't pick that.
That was
I'm sorry. Your last pick. I don't remember your last pick.
Chris Lowe's not with us tonight. He's a big loser.
No, I think he. If I remember from the Facebook messages, he was talking about work related stuff.
Yeah, I know that.
Which sucks.
He's still a loser.
All right. Yeah, he's still a loser. Anyway, okay. So we're gonna proceed on here. So before we start talking about Bayonetta, there are some other games that have come about that should be made mentioning. Have both of you played Overwatch by any chance?
Yeah, played the beta. Yep.
No sir.
Oh, you haven't played it, Ben?
No sir.
Oh, that sucks. So, Josh, you played on the PS4, right?
I did. Yep.
How did that feel?
You know, I played it the first time. I played it by myself. I didn't have any team members or anything like that. I just kind of jumped into it. And I had mixed feelings about it when I first tried it because I was kind of, I think, still in traditional first-person shooter mode.
Okay.
I am not super familiar with the, like, character class-based shooter genre, necessarily. Mm-hmm. I never really played Team Fortress, which I think is what this game is likened to most often.
Yes.
So, I don't know if I knew what to expect necessarily, and like it's just a very different type of shooter. You really have to go in and have an open mind and understand that like it's not a level playing field, so to speak, like as far as the abilities and like the controls and things like that. So you really have to just sort of like latch on to what character fits you the best and just understand how the mechanics work and everything like that to get the most out of it. And I don't think I understood that well enough when I first started, and it just kind of turned me off. Mm-hmm. But I stuck with it, and my brother, you know, pinged me, and he was like, hey, I'm on with some buddies. Let's just party up. And so I played for a few hours with them, and I started to get the hang of it, and it was a lot of fun, once you get the hang of it. So, yeah, I don't know that I'm necessarily going to pick it up, but possibly once the price drops. I don't know if it's a $60 purchase for me or not.
Is it one of those things that you're not necessarily a MOBA player at all?
No.
I didn't think so.
Not really.
I was gonna say that seems to. I mean, with the comparison to Team Fortress 2, it kind of makes me think of that. All the stuff I've seen on the game, the playthroughs, the let's plays, and all that makes me think of like a combination between those two types of games. And I'm with all of the stuff going free to play all of a sudden, with like League or Dota, and with Blizzard being able to pretty much run the roost of whatever they want to do, it's not surprising that they are going to put out like a pretty much a $60 like Team Fortress 2 MOBA
first person shooter.
Well, I was going to say amalgamation. Yeah, first person shooter. Type of thing for full price and more if you'd like. So it's not surprising at all. But hey, it looks cool. It's very colorful. It's one of those things that I'll probably look into. I'll probably see a little bit coming up at FortCON here in June.
So for me at least, when I heard it was like a combination, like similar aspects like the Team Fortress 2 class based and whatnot, I knew it was totally up my alley, and the overall design of the game itself was really appealing to me. They've already released 3 cinematics right now, and all those cinematics have been fantastic. the last one that they released is Hanzo and Genji right now, and God, man, it's so good. It's if you haven't watched it, you need to watch them, because I think what Blizzard does is, I heard it on Giant Bomb, and I completely agree. They pick up on what's hot right now, and that's first person shooters, and then they just take the best of both worlds and they make it their own. And right now, Overwatch is going to be, I think it's going to be such a huge, huge success. Apparently, the numbers for the beta, there was a total of 10 million players for the beta. That's crazy.
Hopefully that translates into sales for them.
I hope so too. I'm not sure if it's going to be like a day one purchase for me. That's only mainly because, you know, I'm just cheap. But other than that, no, it's just like, I just have a hard time paying $60
in general. Yeah, it's harder to drop something on an unknown quantity. Yeah. But I think the reason why you have so many people trying it out is, first of all, they've made that beta very accessible. Mm-hmm. Second of all, I think just the Blizzard name can mm-hmm. sell copies. It's just, you know, if you're in the know about, you know, this hobby and this lifestyle, in games in general, it's hard not to throw a rock and not hit a Blizzard game and know what that is.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Blizzard produces quality, and you know, I think when they produce a game, they make it worth your while. I mean, StarCraft 2 was such a huge hit, and it's still.
I don't think we've done a Blizzard game, have we?
No, anyway. We haven't. And the thing is, what's great about Blizzard is that they support their games through and out. I mean, it's just they're such an unbelievable company, and I think that should be commended. So, I am definitely looking forward to playing more Overwatch in the future, and also I've actually been putting together some gameplay footage here in Maverick in the background.
Yep.
Love it. I have put out a couple of YouTube videos on our YouTube channel right now. You do check it out if you get a chance, and see if the game actually entices you if you did not play the game at all. So keep that in mind and check it out. Other things, Josh, you have been played Uncharted 4, so just give us your initial feelings, overall feelings so far. No spoilers or anything. Just what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's amazing. It's what I expected. And I had very, very high expectations. So that's a compliment for sure. Like it's what I would expect out of the studio that just got done with The Last of Us, you know, like as far as the storytelling and just the motion capture and the acting and everything. It's top notch. I mean, it's no other studio still has been able to replicate that level of craftsmanship for storytelling, I think. So just to see that again, and to see an even better graphics engine this time around to go along with that is pretty amazing. So, you know, other than that, I think it captures like the Uncharted gameplay that we've come to know and love. You know, it's still very reminiscent of Tomb Raider, you know, still a lot of kind of parkour and, you know, climbing things and jumping over ledges and things like that. There's a little bit of a heavier, I don't want to say focus, but just an option for stealth this time around. You can read about that in a lot of the reviews. I read that before I started playing it, but I found that to be true. That, you know, if you want to, you can definitely take out a lot of enemies in heavily fortified areas by just kind of sneaking up on them and breaking their necks, Metal Gear solid style. And then when the time is right, you know, if you just want to go balls out and blow some shit up and start shooting, you can do that too. So, I mean, just like Metal Gear Solid 4, I think, or 5 rather, I think we're used to that and we're receptive to that now. So it's exciting to see that a game like this is kind of playing off of that as well. So.
Awesome. Well, I'm glad to hear that it's surpassing expectations. And you know, to be honest with you, I didn't really want an Uncharted 4, but the fact that people are just like gushing over it, it's like, okay, now I'm gonna have to play this game, because I thought it ended perfectly for me, at least. And because, you know, they're kind of literally walking in the sunset at the end of the third game, so I was like, yep, yeah, they're done. And when I heard Uncharted 4 is announced, I'm like, oh really, like, okay. But man, much to my surprise, it's just like rave reviews about it. And by the way, thank you, another plug for our YouTube channel. Josh actually uploaded you uploaded chapter 6, and it's it's a lot of rock climbing in this one, but man, this dude,
the
just so gorgeous.
I would say that this is the best looking game for sure on PlayStation 4. And I think it rivals a lot of PC games, and I think it's just one of the best looking games out there really right now. So take a look, see if you agree. The engine's amazing. So
dude, I've seen snippets online, I'm just it's mind-blowingly good.
Yeah, it really is.
It really, have you seen any footage, Ben?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I watched Josh's footage that he shared, and I think I've avoided everything else only because I know I'm gonna play it eventually.
Yeah.
And the thing that I'm most excited about in all the trailers I've seen and Josh's thing is they seem to have learned a lot with The Last of Us in how to tell a story within the environment without having to do tutorial things and stuff like that. Like, and tutorial things meaning they have you do it and make sense in the context of which you're playing through the segment, rather than being like, press A to throw the bottle and stuff like that. Like,
yeah,
you know, you're now able to the stealth thing is interesting because I believe they picked that up maybe at some, I'm surmising that they might have picked that up during the Last of Us DLC I read about way back on that episode. So because you can actually make it through that whole DLC without alerting anybody, because
you're
small,
right,
and weak when you're Ellie. I mean, you're not weak, but you're smaller and can't take on or even fire certain guns apparently when you're her height and stuff like that, and that just totally makes sense. So it makes you feel more like a thief, I'm sure, when you're playing those segments of Uncharted 4. So yeah, definitely. I'm excited to play it. It'll happen someday.
It's, hopefully soon. You know, as someone who appreciates travel too, like, it's might sound corny, but I mean, you really do get the sense that you're like traveling to different locations in this game, because they're just they do it such justice with the, you know, the weather effects and the lighting and everything like that. Like, I'm in Mozambique now. I was in Scotland earlier. I was in Italy in the clip that I uploaded.
And yeah, then, that's like, the one that looks so good.
Each area just has such a distinct feel to it. It's amazing. Like, Mozambique right now is just, it's jaw-dropping. I should upload just a short clip of that.
It'd be weird to watch an Indiana Jones film where Indiana Jones doesn't travel anywhere and he stays home and has a nice lunch, you know?
Yeah.
That'd be very weird. So, you gotta globe travel, you gotta have at least two or three, it's just like James Bond, too. He travels to, like, three or four different countries per movie, so.
Right. It just makes it much more visually interesting.
Mm-hmm. Well, Josh, I'm glad to hear that it's at least amongst us that it's living up to the hype, and I'm glad. I know someone else personally, I know someone who's playing it too. I know Ryan Picard is playing it, and I know he's really liking it as well. So you guys are pretty much lucky bastards in my opinion, but good. I'm glad to hear it's pretty awesome. Other quick notes, E3, by the time we come out with our, you know, produce another episode, which is Dead Space 3, I believe. In June. E3 is June 14th through June 16th. Nice. So get ready for that. I'm excited.
We live streaming?
I don't know about that, man. And then also here in Fort Wayne, Ben, you are going to be at FortCON on June 10th. So do you want to, like, do a little plug for them real quick?
So the company Fortland is having, they used to have, like, Fortland every other, you know, 6 months or so. They'd have a new one at Indiana Tech in Fort Wayne. But now this is their first ever FortCON. It's going to be June 10th through the 12th, 6 o'clock on June 10th, Friday, and it ends on Sunday at 3. It's going to be at the Grand Wayne Center downtown. It's got all sorts of different tournaments. What kind of tournament? I mean, they had league tournaments. They had TF2 tournaments. What else do they have? They had a Rocket League one, and I believe that's still on the list for this round. I don't know if they're going to do Overwatch. It might be too new for people.
Comes up May 24th, people might not be, so I don't know.
This is going to be the place where they're going to learn about Overwatch. There's probably going to be some pickup games, and then I guarantee you the next Fortland they're gonna have, or the next FortCON they're going to have Overwatch. But this is like a bring-your-own-computer tournament weekend where you come and you can play games. You can play co-op games, pickup games. You don't necessarily have to participate in any of the tournaments, but it is a good idea to come with a team of Rocket Leagues, Rocket Leaguers, you know, if that's your thing.
They also PC?
It is not only PC. They are having console tournaments as well. I think Street Fighter V is going to be on Friday. Super Smash, I believe they have a Melee one for the GameCube. And then Super Smash for the Wii U. That one's going to be...
Yeah.
Oh, no. It's just for the Wii U. The Brawl is for the Wii. They're having the Wii U one on Saturday. They have Black Ops 2, you know, 2v2 and stuff like that as well. There's a hotel connected to both the Grand Wayne Center and across the street at the Courtyard Marriott. You can go to landreg.org/Fortland/FortCON, and all those details are there. It looks like they have, at this point when we're recording this, 79 bring your own computer registration 36 inch space left. It's $50. The VIP registration is all sold out. That came with like a shirt and a much larger space, 48 inches. But yeah, there are 79 seats left out of 256 total seats, so they're filling up, and this one's gonna be bigger. They are also gonna have, I was told, they're gonna have what is that, the Steam VR or Vive, the HTC Vive. You have to sign up to try it out. I think I'm gonna schedule myself to do the HTC Vive.
I didn't know that.
Tryouts. I'm gonna, you know, just a virtual reality demo. That way, I can have my first, you know. So hopefully, by the next time we record, maybe I'll have played some virtual reality games, and I can tell you a little bit about them. And that's the one I wanted to try, was the HTC Vive. That's the one I was most interested in, and the most expensive. So, yeah.
Dude, that's I did not know. They were going
to
do that.
And you can come in. You don't have to pay just to be a part of it. You can also, I don't know what the, I don't have it in front of me, how much it is just to come in and watch or hang out for a little while or so. I think it's like maybe $5-$10 or whatever just to come in. But you might be able to snag a time to try out the VR as well. So yeah, and they do all sorts of charity raffles and stuff like that. You are going to win, if you are in the in any of the drawings, you're going to win something. You know, everyone gets their name drawn at some point, or you go home with, you know, some weird, bizarre computer part that you have no use for. But it's still, like, people can win laptops and, or not laptops, excuse me, keyboards and all sorts of stuff. I got a t-shirt when I went there and a few other, you know, doodads and whatnot. So, yep, definitely check it out. And that's going to be in the middle of June. So, yeah. Right around E3. So
awesome. I'm looking, dude, that's pretty dope, to say the truth. So I'm excited. Yeah. I'm really excited to hear that, man. All right, well, I think that brings into our icebreaker. I'm just coming up with really a shitty name for B-roll, but and I want to steal it from Three Shots. So anyway, we're gonna go on to Bayonetta.
Ooh.
So Bayonetta came out in 2009. Okay, so I actually looked up what games came out in 2009, and it's actually a pretty it's a recognizable list. So we have Left 4 Dead 2, Assassin's Creed 2, Borderlands, Batman Arkham Asylum, and Uncharted 2. So this game came out amongst like a plethora of, I guess you would say, well-received games, for sure. And Bayonetta, like, when I think of Bayonetta out of that whole mix, that's, it's kind of like, like, what is Bayonetta? Like, that's the thing. So, I first want to kick it off. The introduction to this game is, how I want to put it, very thick. It lays it on very thick with its absurdity, because everything about this game I would like to classify as hyper. That means hyper sexualized, hyper violence. The characters are just over the top. The world, these worlds are just crazy in themselves. The villains, everything about it is just so over the top. But the thing is, in the prologue, it doesn't ease into it. It just like kind of just like throws it at your face, and I didn't know how to digest it at first, because I was really taken back by it. I don't know. Did Josh, I was talking to our, you know, to our group on Facebook, and it seemed like you had a similar reaction.
Yeah, no, I it's batshit crazy. Like, it just, I stopped even trying to like understand the story. Probably like 15 minutes in,
I was like, very surprised that you picked it. You know, it was one of those things. Like, yeah, I want to do Bayonetta.
Crazy ass, like, Japanese what? People.
That's
like, this is just absurd. But once you kind of embrace that, and you're just like, ugh, whatever.
What system did you play it on?
I played it on Xbox 360.
Oh, sweet. Yep.
And I didn't know this, but I like took a glance at some reviews just recently, and I guess the PlayStation 3 version actually has a lot of technical problems.
Yep, there's a lot of loading times in like the PlayStation 3 when you go into new. From what I've read, like they go into like to different aspects of the world. Like the only loading times that I recalled was actually, you know, when you're able to test out your moves and all that, and all that sort of junk and everything. But after, you know, after that, like, there's no loading times actually during gameplay. That was one of the things the game was ripped apart on for the PS3, because the PS3 didn't do so well. Like, it received like a moderately good score, like, you know, like 7s and 8s, but the 360 actually just, you know, wiped the floor
completely. IGN gave it a 9.5, just to throw that out there.
9.5 from IGN and Edge UK. Edge is a big magazine over in the United Kingdom. Magazine. Mm-hmm. 10 out of 10.
Wow. I wouldn't go that far.
Yeah. I just wanted to point that out, because I was like, oh, whoa.
Yeah.
Someone loves that.
Here's the thing. This is really the biggest gripe. One of the biggest gripes I have with the game, it's just that it doesn't ease into it. It's just, like I said, it just puts you into the thick of it, but it's not the kind of good thick of it where you're just like, oh, this is kind of mysterious, I'm into it. It's more like things are just happening, and you're just like, I don't even know what the
are you talking about. I'm both story here. And gameplay, and, or are you talking about just both?
Both at the same time. Yeah,
that's
because
interesting.
I don't think at that point you barely played any of it, except for that that voiceover that was happening in the beginning of the game when you're fighting along Jean. But after that, it was all cutscenes, and it just kept going on and on. And when she finally goes into her, like, her, you know, her signature skin tight black leather costume, it's at first she's like wearing that like white gown or whatever it is, and it slits, you know, these slits, you know, these like these angels, whatever you want to call them, just slip, and you know, you get a little bit of it, you get a little bit of an ass, and you get a little bit of some under tit shots going on here, and I'm just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, well, I was gonna ask you, what did you two think of the sexuality in this game? Because that was one thing that I knew going in, so I wasn't surprised.
Yeah,
but I don't think I was very bothered by it. I don't think I
was. Didn't bother me.
I can see some people that would get bothered, why it would be, but I honestly think that the character is actually pretty darn cool for what is going on and what she's doing. Like, obviously it's kind of cheesy. It's cheesy as all get out and the things she's saying in her one-liners and stuff like that. But I actually think that at no point is Bayonetta the, you know, lack of a better term, butt of the joke. I don't think she's the one. She's always in control, and she's and in control of, you know, her own body and her own sexuality and stuff like that. She's not pining after anybody. In fact, all the men in the game get crushed underneath her heel. You know, it's just kind of, it's kind of literally. Yeah, literally. And I just think it's a, I'm actually kind of excited by that fact of the game. Like, I wish there was more, because that's great that a character can be sexualized and can be this object of desire in this cool kind of way, because it's the same way that you know this game's cousin Dante from Devil May Cry, he's kind of a sexualized character for females as well, or for men as well, to see in this game, going around like with a shirt, you know, like half, you know, no shirt in an overcoat and stuff like that. It's very interesting to see the tables turn in that way. So I think that was a question, but I think, who knows what it was. So sorry.
No, for me at least, at first I was just like, okay, this is totally pandering to the males right here, because this shot of like getting an under tit shot and some ass, and as she is bending over, like the first time you're seeing this, it feels very male centered, and so I was like, okay, this is going to be this type of game. But as you progress further on, you are right, though. She is in control. And the more you become involved with the absurdity that this game is, it makes sense as to why she's the way she is. So I gradually, I guess you would say, what's the word I'm looking for?
Acclimated?
Yes, that's the word. I just couldn't figure it out. Yeah, I became more acclimated to it, and then I began enjoying it more. And after that, I was just like, everything that was happening, I was just like, fuck yeah, this is amazing. And after that, I was like, okay, now I'm all in. It's kind of like with Face Off. Like, man, either you like it or you don't like it. And I don't know anybody who's ever been middling about Face Off. You know, the one with John Travolta and Nick Cage. Like, you are for it or you're against it. Like, it's just pure absolution. With Bayonetta, I feel like you're either for it or you're against it. And
yeah,
I'm all for it.
Yeah,
I'm
with a game like this, I feel like it's you could draw a parallel to, like, a certain director or something like that for movies, right? Like you either love like Tarantino or you don't, right? Like you just go in understanding that Tarantino movies are the way they are, and it's they're over the top, and you know, there's shocking like gore and things like that, and like you're either on board or you're not. Like, what's up, man?
Yeah. I was totally on board after a while. Like, it just took me a while to get used to her, and I was like, oh, this all makes sense now. There's a purpose for this. It's not just for the sake of, you know, guys to, you know, oogle at her. And I remember, like, I remember Anita Sarkeesian, the whole Gamergate thing, as she's affiliated with. You know, I'm all for, like, you know, women equality in, you know, video games and all that sorts. But she made like a Captain Obvious statement about how Bayonetta is just like, you know, really pandering to males. I'm like, well, duh, like, give me a fucking break. But at the same time, when I played more of this now and thinking back at her statement, I'm like, you know, I get that she's hypersexualized and all that stuff. But Ben, like I said, you made a point that she's always in control, and that's the one-up she has over these other characters.
And her interests don't lie in a male. Like, Sarkeesian seems to talk about the Bechdel the Bechdel test for certain things where the female protagonist isn't pining to be a, or in any way trying to serve a man, or to be a girlfriend or a wife or a mother to somebody. It's always, it's a traditional female role. She is trying to be a sister to the other mm-hmm. woman and stuff like that, and trying to seek out revenge or trying to get the end bad guy. The gentleman mm-hmm. and the daughter that her quote unquote daughter that follows her around throughout the game. Yes, there are interests. Yes, there is a little bit of mothering that happens and stuff like that, but not in a way that never in a way that doesn't seem like it's forced upon her. In a way that she mm-hmm. wouldn't have a choice there. I never feel like she's never in, I don't know. It none of it ever seems dirty or gross in ways that a game can feel that way.
I absolutely agree. Like Luca pining over her was actually pretty hilarious.
Well, because... and the way he's denying it too. Oh, I don't like you, or whatever you're saying. Yeah.
And I thought that was pretty cool, because I'm like, oh, it's nothing new, but the roles are reversed. And there's one moment in the game where you thought they were going to do it, and she kind of gives him the slip. And do you remember what I'm talking about?
I don't remember the one spot you're talking about. I just remember it happening many times throughout the game where mm-hmm. You feel like she could be interested, but then at the end she's just like, nope. Like, but she is the tight leather what's it called, dominatrix type of character in this game. I mean, she is literally stepping on angels and torturing, even in some of her torture devices that you can use as your special attacks and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. All of that has a very dominating dominatrix type of vibe to it, which, once again, it's one of those things that this is a podcast just full of men. I don't think we've ever had a female guest at all, at least I don't think. And if we have, I'm sorry, but no, I don't think we have. It's one of those things where, I realize it's just a sausage fest here on the co-op mode, but it's one of those things where, we at least realize where this is going and what this game mm-hmm. is trying to say in terms of, but if you look at the pat, like, this is directed by Hideki Kiyama, who's directed, Resident Evil, Beautiful Joe, mm-hmm. The Devil May Cry series, Okami, Wonderful 101. Like, this isn't his first time making a game with this over-the-top, type of... this is extremely over-the-top, but to a mm-hmm. point where it's not gratuitous and disgusting, Some people may view it that way, but I would argue, and I think there's evidence here... within the game, if you play it, that it is not, simply for the fact that she is so powerful, and so much power is given mm-hmm. to her. So
yeah, and with that power, it's actually a nice segue, because the gameplay is a button mashing fiesta. However, I think. I was watching the game, like the demo of the game playing throughout after, its title screen and everything. And I was watching the AI, like, link different combinations together so fluidly. And maybe I'm just not good at it, but I had a really hard time doing that.
Let me tell you, do you mind if I go off the rails a little bit on something I was going to bring here to this discussion?
Okay.
Hear me out for just a little bit. This month wasn't actually Bayonetta month for me, Josh. It was actually Platinum month. This is the first time I've ever played a Platinum game. and I didn't just play Bayonetta. I played Vanquish as well.
Ooh.
And in that time, I finished both games... And I did some research, and I came across a YouTube channel called Game Maker's Toolkit, who is written and produced by Mark Brown. So thank you, Mark Brown, for all this information. But he talks about platinum games having depth and mastery, in, as opposed to something like a God of War, where you are button mashing and you're literally doing, like, you know, all your combos and stuff like that in your different ways. The way Platinum does it differently is laid out in this Game Maker's Toolkit video. You have your level one, which SB just alluded to. Level one people are your learners. I would be under this as well, SB. You just brute force button mash your way. You have the loosest grasp on the game systems. You can still have fun, but even with the bad scores but you kind of look awkward when you're doing all the combos and stuff like that, you can get your way through it. The game is designed for you to be able to button mash and to just, like, try different things out and not really understand the game systems. The game has that depth when you go to levels 2 and 3. Level 2 is the players. That depth that Mark Brown's talking about, and Platinum is alluding to, allows learned players to get more out of the game, more interesting decisions, and you're able to express yourself. Now, these examples were found both in Bayonetta and Vanquish, and I'll get to Vanquish here in a second because there's a little bit with that one as well. But you can you're watching a video of someone flawlessly coming out with combos and stuff like that, and Platinum is able to have you do these button mashing in a certain order. And timing to chain them all together, but it's not like SB that you weren't ever able to do that in the first place. It's not like it was locked behind a fence. Mm-hmm. You would have been able to if you only had the knowledge and the ability that you have with your fingers and your timing and stuff like that to be able to master that. You would be able to do it. What I'm trying to say is, in God of War, if you wanna unlock an ability, you have to pay all this, like, blood money or blood gold or whatever, you know, whatever it is, to unlock a new ability. Platinum doesn't work that way. You have the ability from the get-go to be able to pull off these, you know, awesome moves. You just don't, you know, when you're a beginner like me or Espy, you don't have the ability right away because you don't have the knowledge or the power yet. And then, of course, level three is the master. It's even more depth, high level manic finger combos and all that, pretty much what happens in level 2. You have the ability to do it all from the get-go, but that needed knowledge and time to figure it out helps. So yeah, that's all. I only wanted to spend a little bit of time on that, but I found that very interesting because you're seeing that throughout all of Platinum's games: Mad World, Vanquish, Metal Gear Rising, Revengeance, Wonderful 101, and even Bayonetta 2 that just came out a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. It's one of those, it's just one of those things that they do it differently, and somehow it just appeals to everyone. Like, someone like me, who doesn't normally play these types of games, can. And something like, and it can even be done with shooters like Vanquish. You see these games all the time, with like Tony Hawk, you know. My wife said she used to play, she didn't call it the GameCube, she called it the Game Box. And you could play, she said she loved playing Tony Hawk 3 on it, because she knew how to ollie and jump onto something and then just hit a bunch of buttons and do a big combo or whatever. It's very satisfying to see those numbers rise and rise, even though you don't know what you're doing with your fingers. But a learned skater can jump from combo to combo to combo and get really bigger, higher scores, and that's where that appeal of this game comes from. So
it's a nice
section right there. I highly recommend Game Maker's Toolkit, Mark Brown on YouTube. If we can link to that, that would be awesome. The guy does a super good job, and I'm sorry, Mark. I get your stuff for free, and I don't pay the Patreon for a thing a month. But I plan to help you
savage.
In some way. Yeah,
you
spreading the good word about your channel,
bastard. I think what you're touching upon is pretty much it. Like, I would practice, like, during the load times, different combos and everything, but I think it's when it just comes in the heat of the battle, I'm not thinking clearly. I'm thinking frantically because I just want to, like, beat the shit out of them.
And while you may die a few times, you still get through, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Like, I don't feel like I ever get punished, but I just don't feel like I just know enough. And I also felt like my combos, like, were they ever in your books? Like, I just don't remember if they were ever in your books, because I always felt like I had to wait for the load screen. Maybe that's
I don't think so.
An error.
And some of the moves in Bayonetta and Vanquish, they do not tell you how to do it. This is one of those things where, through experimentation and just by playing it over and over again, you can learn these, like, they don't teach you how to do a special move that lets you extend witch time or something like that, or there's a special witch time in Vanquish, I can't remember what it's called, I think it's called AR mode, where you jump over cover and he immediately goes into slow-mo and you can shoot. If you throw a grenade at that same time in slow motion, throw a grenade into a group of enemies in slow motion, you can shoot that grenade and involve splash damage into your attack. And so it's such a cool thing that
it's dope.
They don't teach you that. But I did because of this thing. It was really cool. So that is the magic of Platinum games. And so Bayonetta has a little bit. I'll do a real quick little comparison with those two games. I think Bayonetta has more personality. I think that one is wild in comparison to a very white bread, you know, very kind of. It's not that it looks bad and it plays bad. It actually plays very well. It's just I think Bayonetta is a great game, and I think Vanquish is a good game, just a damn good game that is worth looking into. But I, you know, much like Bayonetta, I couldn't be less interested. I couldn't be more interested. Less interested. I didn't care about the story in either game. What was fascinating about it, about both games, was this ability to experiment and express yourself through the attacks that the game allows you to look at. So.
Oddly enough, I was actually interested in Bayonetta's story because she actually started caring about Cereza. Mm. Which threw me off because I was not expecting that at all. Like, she actually became like a maternal. She became maternal in the game for a little bit, and I'm just like, this is totally like breaking the stereotype right now that I have.
You don't see it very often in games.
No, not at all. So when she started doing that, like letting her guard down more, I actually got more invested into the story, surprisingly. And I was just like, is this really happening right now? Because I'm actually taken back by it. Because at first, let me tell you about Enzo. That Joe Pesci sleazy stepbrother should just like get the fuck out of the game in the first place.
You don't like Enzo?
Oh my god. Man, fuck that guy. Like I said, he just reminded me of Joe Pesci, but just like 10 times worse.
Yeah,
like,
he is kind of a bad stereotypical Italian American character, and it's a little disturbing. Oh, like, if this was any other nationality, we'd be calling it racist or something like that, I feel like.
Yeah, he really bothered me. I was like, mother, why is this guy even in this game? Like, I'm just so fixated on him because he's like, he feels like he's really out of place, even though he's over the top, he's absurd as well. But for whatever reason, like his ethnicity, his nationality, and from what I've seen in films and other, you know, other mediums, I'm like, this is kind of stereotypical. This is weird.
I wonder if he is in the sequel. And I wonder God, if they, because I feel like a character like Enzo could be really useful in a humanizing Bayonetta, but humanizing the situation. Like, we can see mm-hmm. Bayonetta's world and craziness through his eyes. Like not that mm-hmm. I want the game to be about Enzo, but like, he's the one a tombstone almost falls on his crotch and he just goes, oh no, like, oh my gosh, you know, he's like running away, and in a way mm-hmm. I kind of feel that I get it, because she's extremely powerful and she seemingly has no consequences for her beating up angels like crazy, but if I'm Enzo, I am like running for my life, running for cover, because bullets are flying everywhere and dead angel bodies are raining down on me. So I would be a little scared. So in a way, Enzo serves as that, at least at the very beginning, a way of I think showing through human eyes what the world of Bayonetta is like. But then all that shit goes out the window and you are completely locked in with Bayonetta and what her life is and how nuts it is.
Dude, some of those character designs of the enemies, that's got to be some... I just kept thinking, am I playing Final Fantasy right now? Because, like, it's not a bad thing, but I felt like I was playing Final Fantasy for quite a bit when I was facing, like, especially those boss battles, man. Like, the design of these villains are just, like, heavily imbued, like, with religion. Like, they look religious, or they look like they're, you know, straight, like, something like mythology, or, you know, maybe Greek or something like that. I was just really taken back by just the design of them. And then the boss battles, like, I'm mixed on those because it just kept going on really fucking long. Like, I think, I can't remember which one it was. It's the one that had the tentacles, and that boss battle took a really long time. It was at the airport or something like that, and I just remember thinking, I just kept falling down in that purple goop, whatever it was, and then I would have to avoid getting eaten by evading it. And
I totally forget that one. It's been about like a month since east. I played it, so I don't know. Is it more towards the end of the game?
Yeah, it's like chapter 9, chapter 10.
Oh, okay.
Around there. Yeah, it just took a while. It just took such a long ass time for me to be.
Well, you mentioned something about like the look in the angels and in Bayonetta's more like the bad girl or devil type of imagery. I think even the character when you go down to the gates of hell and buy stuff from, I can't think of his name. Rodan. Yeah, he like, I like that idea that you're the good, quote, the good guys, but essentially you're all devil. I mean, it's all hell and stuff like that, and you're fighting angels. I thought that was an interesting take on stuff. Yeah, I'm with you. Some of the bosses look, you're right, I like that comparison to Final Fantasy, but none of it ever looked bad. Like, it's all very, and I think these platinum games all like to be like at least 30 frames. It's very, very beautifully animated and stuff like that, and very imaginative. And I gotta be careful with how I say this, because I don't want to make it seem like I didn't like it. It's just, these were incredible designs and beautiful looking on what the 360 can do, at least. It's the only version I can speak for 2009. But it was one of those things that if we weren't playing it for the show, I don't know how far I would have gotten into it. I don't know how far I would have taken this game. I just don't know, because it's one of those things where I think I have tried playing it before, whether it was a demo or something like that, and I think we just got far enough in it that I got far enough in it that I'm like, okay, I think I've seen enough or something like that. I didn't see. I don't know if I would have seen it all the way through to its conclusion in the game, the way I did for the show. So,
Chris was saying one of the things that he had mentioned to us on Facebook that, you know, he really loves the gameplay. He loves the combat, and I guess he was saying that everything on paper about this game should technically like work for him, but for whatever reason, I don't think he went specific.
Yeah, he loves anime, and he loves that type of over the topness. He likes like a good beat 'em up and stuff like that, and you know, punch, you know, combos and stuff like that. He likes those types of games. But he started and stopped this game four times. He borrowed my Xbox 360 to play it and my copy of the game, and just said, "Yeah, I'm just going to give that back to you. There's no way I'm going to finish this before we start." And I'm honestly that same guy. Only I started and stopped it twice, and then on third time's a charm for me. So, and I'm glad I did, because I finished it and I thought it was a very well designed game. But once again, like, I'm not of that culture. I'm not of that mindset. It's hard for me, a more Western mind, you know, and what my likes and sensibilities are for me to get into something like this. Yeah, it's just, unless we're playing it for the show, I don't know. I highly doubt I would have been putting this one down as one that I've played. But now I'm glad I can say that I did.
I'm very happy too. Josh, did you want to add anything about the boss battles?
No, I think you guys summed it up pretty well. They're kind of crazy, and you know, I mean, like the cinematography is pretty interesting. It definitely swings things around, and like I don't know, it can be disorienting at times, but it definitely mixes things up. So
I guess we should go into final thoughts here. Ben, do you want to kick us off?
Yeah, that's fine. For the most part, I've already kind of alluded to how my feelings on this game. Is this where we give it a score to?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah,
I've done this before. I'm gonna give it an 8.5. It's one of those that I like. It's hard for me to score it because I've never had a game where the subject matter didn't really interest me, but it intrigued me more. But I love the design of this game, and I love the mechanics, and I love how all of that is laid out for you to figure out. If someone were to ask me at this point in time, do you like Bayonetta? I, of course, would say yes. Would you play a sequel? My answer would be yes. Would it get me to buy a Wii U? Yes. I mean, eventually. But if and when I do get a Wii U, Bayonetta is going to be one of those games that I'm going to be putting on the pile and wanting to play, simply for the fact that it's made by Platinum. I'm now a Platinum fan. I'm looking forward to
the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles game.
That's right. They are putting out the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles game.
Jeez. Okay.
I'm looking forward to actually playing Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, though. I've only started it, and that one definitely has like a taking the best of both worlds with Bayonetta and Vanquish and kind of putting them together.
Really?
It's a beautiful looking game, and very smooth frame rate and stuff like that, but it has that ridiculous like personality. I feel like Vanquish is missing personality. It's trying too hard to be a bunch of different things. Gears of War, Metal Gear. It's trying too hard to be all of that. And while it looks good doing it, there's no personality. Bayonetta is nothing but personality. Like it's almost like someone just sat down and thought, let's create our own style for a game, and this is what they came up with. And it's one of those that I recommend finding it on the Xbox because it's not like the PS3 is having issues.
Yeah,
you could probably pick that up for really cheap. I would assume under $20. And sure. I always make recommendations. I recommend playing Bayonetta all the way through, power through it. The first bit might be hard for you to get through. It was hard for Chris and me, but if you're a learner like I am, you'll make it through, and come out with a good game experience. Maybe not the best, but it certainly is intriguing and fun.
Yep, I'm giving it an 8. I will say, just say what Ben had said. I would echo what Ben said, that the very beginning, it is a lot to take in. So I would say all players, I would say that just give it a moment to breathe, because it's gonna lay it on thick.
Right? Like a fine wine. Give it time to breathe.
Yeah. It's going to be so thick at first, but after a while, because I was in that boat where I was like, I don't know if I can play this game. I really thought about it, and I stayed with it. And like what we mentioned in the review, that I enjoy this, do not judge a book by its cover. Okay, this is a game where if you were a consumer and you would walk by this game and you look at the art design, you would immediately think like this game is misogynistic because of its female protagonist. It could not be any more wrong. I'm gonna say that right now. It could not be any more wrong, because she breaks conventions. She does not pine after men. She is, she can defend herself. She could totally, she could take care of herself, and she welcomes the danger. She's like, all right, I'm gonna handle you bitches. I don't care. And it kind of plays with your expectations a little bit. Is she gonna hook up with this other dude? Is she not? Oh no, of course she isn't. She doesn't need a guy. She could have any guy if she really wanted to, because all of them pine after her. But she don't care. And that's the best part. She doesn't care. She passes the Bechdel test for men. So I mean, it's really good. It's a lot of fun. And I suggest that if you are into this type of anime sort of thing, I'm gonna say anime. It feels very anime. Over the top absurdity, this game is totally up your alley. Played on 360 though, because from what I've read, like Ben mentioned, the PS3 has a lot of technical performance issues, so recommended 360 all the way. All back to you, Josh.
Yeah, I'll give it an 8.5. I agree with Ben's score. You guys said a lot of what I was gonna say. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a fun game. Like if you are in a Devil May Cry or any game, and any action game that just allows you to perform crazy over the top combos and unlock new weapons and things like that, come with an open mind and I think you'll have a good time.
Come with an open mind and I think you'll have a good time. Hey, I like that.
And don't worry about the story. That's the other thing. Just if you really want to follow it, go for it. But I mean, it's just
good luck. Yeah, that's all I gotta say. Good luck. I try to really follow it, and I'm just like, he's a bad guy, right? I'm just gonna kill him.
Yeah, style over substance.
It's a rarity where that works for me. Anyway, Josh and Ben, thank you for thank you for taking the time to play this game, and I'm glad that all of us had a good time with it. I hope our next game that we're going to be experiencing, Dead Space 3, is a good time as well. Have any of you guys played it?
I've probably played maybe like 2 hours, maybe 3 hours of it. It's good.
Okay.
It is very good. I'm excited to play it.
Okay. Ben, I know
you've played some. All of it. Going to spoil what I think about it, because I want you to tune into the next episode and find out what you thought of it with me.
All right.
Okay. Josh, are you playing solo though?
Solo? Yeah, I had been. Is it co-op?
Okay.
You can co-op. I actually don't know. We should actually talk about this and on the show for people that at home that are playing along or wanted to play along. You can obviously play through the single player all by itself. Mm-hmm. There are moments where it contextually lets you play co-op, and it fits that into the story. I want to say rather well.
Interesting.
Like shoehorn in it. Mm-hmm. I guess we'll see next month. But like there are moments where you might split up, you might see content, or you might fight monsters in a certain section of the level that you wouldn't normally if you were Isaac. So I heard mm-hmm. if you play through the first way, the second time you play, you should play as the partner, whoever helps Isaac. I would actually ask if I could play as that character this time, SB, if we're doing that. But it's up to you.
Yeah, we should.
But especially since that's you're playing fine. As Isaac the first time, I don't know all this for sure. I have to research this or whatever, but.
And I've read that the DLC, The Awakening, is actually what they consider to be like the true
ending. Which I have not experienced, and I would like to see that because the ending I got, I don't know if I was fully satisfied. In fact, I don't even really remember it. That's how much of an I remember the ending to 2 more than I remember the ending to 3, if that gives you any indication about how good 2 is. So.
Yeah. I've read online that if you want the, I guess, what they call the truer ending, in quotation marks, the Awakening DLC is the one to play, to download. So depending on what platform you play on, I got it on PC, and I bought it dirt cheap for like $1 when I was on sale. Whoa. So I was like,
oh, nice.
I know.
I got it for free on PlayStation 3.
Well,
fuck yeah. Hey,
so you overpaid, yeah. Motherfucker. No.
Yeah, I did. I love it. I love it. All right. So that'll be our June episode, and that's why we do a monthly game, because this gives, you know, not only us but other listeners of the show, you know, who listen to the show, you know, to take part in this as well. So just think about it. You have roughly about 30 days to, you know, play a game. So then that's, you know, that works out for us best. So
hells yeah,
that's awesome. Hell sweet. Yeah. And that's, I think, and I love it. So with that being said, for all things co-op mode reviews, you can find us on the internet, of course. You can find us on Facebook. You can find us on Twitter at co-op mode reviews. You can send an email to us. It's at, you know, our website name at gmail.com. Or speaking of our website, go to co-modereviews.com. And will you be able to see all our past episodes available at your leisure? Sift through the site, check out the scores page. You know, that got a nice little facelift last year. I hope people like it very much, because I am not a web dude, and that really took me a really long effing time to build. So be thankful, you bastards. Hey. I hate you. And aside from that, support, if you are in the Fort Wayne area, do check out FortCON, because Ben and I did Fortland back in February. That was a lot of fun to do. It's really great to, you know, mingle with other people. And one of our future guests for Chrono Trigger, Trevor Froberg, he will be on the show. We're going to have to be playing that game way in advance, by the way. but aside from that, he will be on the show, and he's also in charge of Fortland, FortCON. So if you ever see him, give him a shout out for, you know, making things happening within the Fort Wayne area, because that's always awesome. So anyway, we are signing out. Thank you guys for tuning in, and do have a good day, and we'll be back in June with Dead Space 3.